Good afternoon. Thank you so much for coming. A special thanks to Bill Phelan and, of course, Carla Pena for making this trip happen today. This map powerfully illustrates what I identify as a spatial paradox in conservation in Guatemala's Maya Biosphere Reserve. In the western half of the 8,300 square mile reserve, national parks with the strictest land use restrictions have experienced some of the highest deforestation rates in the world. While in the east, home to community forestry, where people are allowed to live and work, we have seen forest cover fare much better. Yet this area, the multiple use zone in the east, home to community forestry concessions, has experienced a lot of unevenness in terms of the outcomes, the conservation outcomes of community forestry. My research, which is part of a larger book project, is trying to get at what dynamics are driving deforestation in the strictest areas of conservation in the reserve. In the West, the two national large parks have gone up in flames since the reserve's creation in 1990. And what factors explain the successful yet uneven conservation outcomes of community forestry in the East in the multiple use zone? Today, I'm going to tell you a little bit about my methodology, and we'll spend most of our time talking about a phenomenon that's locally known as narco ganadería, narco cattle ranching. And I'm going to argue that narco cattle ranching is the number one driver of deforestation in those national parks, in those western areas of strict conservation. Then we'll spend a little bit less time talking about what's responsible for remaining forest cover in the east, community forestry. And then we'll talk about some policy implications and analytical contributions of this research. I want to give you a sense of where I'm heading with this argument, however. I'm going to argue that the story of the Maya Biosphere Reserve shows that community-led resource management is a viable social and environmental justice strategy. Justice is italicized here because we're talking about a post-war era in Guatemala that has failed to bring peace. And this movement is providing opportunities for life and livelihood for community forest concessionaires. Second, I'm going to advocate for developing what we might call a body of literature, narco-ecologies, a political ecology or an environmental anthropological approach to understanding the environmental impacts of both drug production and drug trafficking, and they're different. And then lastly, I'll argue that environmental policy is drug policy in the Americas. So my research is based on 2 years of ethnographic research spent in the Maya Biosphere Reserve in the department or state of Petén, the largest department. I spent a year in the two villages of Carmelita and Huachactún, which are also concessions today by the same name. These villages were established by the Wrigley's Chewing Gum Company in the early 1900s. And since spending 2 years in these two communities, small communities of 300 and 1,200 people respectively, I've returned back to the Maya Biosphere 2 times a year for about 2 weeks each trip. And since I started my new position at Texas State in the fall of 2015, I have been working with a colleague, Dr. Nate Currit, to bring remote sensing and GIS methods to bear on this research project. So in the last year and a half, this research has really become a mixed methods project rather than strictly ethnography alone. The Maya Biosphere was created in 1990 in the middle of Guatemala's peace process. Conservationists were concerned with the rapid deforestation and biodiversity loss in the area. As many of you know, the Civil War ended in 1996 after 36 years, and the United Nations and the Catholic Church determined that the Guatemalan state had committed genocide against the Maya indigenous majority, and that the state was responsible for 93% of civilian casualties. Unfortunately, the peace accords failed to address the deep-rooted causes of civil unrest. Powerful members of the oligarchy and the military with ties to criminal organizations remained in power, And the market-assisted land reform led by the World Bank, a market-based approach to land redistribution, failed to address the problem of land tenure inequality in Guatemala, one of the most unequal land tenure systems in the world, then and now. And in fact, market-assisted land reform since 1996 has simply led to a reconcentration of lands rather than redistributing lands as the program originally intended. Now, this enduring system of unequal land tenure has forced many of Guatemala's poorest indigenous Quechua Maya to settle in the national parks in the west, to farm, to live, because they're simply too poor to legally exist and farm anywhere else. Many of the people who have moved into the Maya Biosphere Reserve, we have landless farmers moving into those national parks in the west. They are contributing to deforestation, but I'm going to argue it's a much smaller scale than cattle ranching. But also the indigenous peasants who have settled illegally in the western part of the Maya Biosphere, many of them were returned refugees after the war ended in 1996. Nonetheless, the Guatemalan state argues that these farmers are illegally practicing Swidden agriculture and are responsible for deforestation in the western part of the Maya Biosphere. The geography of the Maya Biosphere is complex. It's comprised of three different zones, which correspond to different types of land tenure and land use restrictions. The national parks are in the nuclear zone, that middle gray color. You'll see in the west, in the top, we have Laguna del Tigre. I'm going to be talking a lot about that particular park. Sierra de la Candón, Mirador and Tikal. No one is supposed to live or work in the nuclear zones. The multiple use zone is home to community forestry and also to industrial forest concessions. But in the nuclear zones and the multiple use zones, cattle possession is prohibited, as well as land sales. There should be no cattle anywhere in the Maya Biosphere Reserve, except for in the buffer zone, which has no land use restrictions. It's simply supposed to buffer the transition from non-park to park land. Okay, everybody got that? No cattle permitted whatsoever in the multiple use zone or the nuclear zone. However, people who are born in the reserve or marry into families living in the reserve can legally reside in the multiple use zone under strict conservation regulations. And indeed, all of the people who are legally residing in the multiple use zone are part of the community forestry system or live in villages that have concessions. Since the creation of the Maya Biosphere Reserve in 1990, the Guatemalan state has been unable and sometimes unwilling to implement conservation law. And when the Mexican drug wars got really hot in the late 90s and the early 2000s, many Mexican drug cartels began to relocate their trafficking efforts into weaker states surrounding Mexico, primarily Guatemala, Honduras, El Salvador, Nicaragua. But of course, that includes three countries that are the Northern Triangle, right? Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador. Called the Northern Triangle, defined by their high levels of violence, impunity, and poverty, and political insecurity across the board. So when the Mexican cartels started to come into the Maya Biosphere Reserve, they began to launder drug money through cattle ranching. Now, cattle ranching is the perfect business for money laundering for DTOs, drug trafficking organizations. One, you can launder, wash money, large sums of money, within a short period of time. Cattle are one of the only industries that don't require a receipt of purchase to submit to the government. So you can spend $500,000 on 1,000 head of cattle if you're a narco rancher, and a year later sell that herd legally, have a receipt, money laundered, and you made a little bit money on the weight that the cattle had gained the time that you were ranching them. But also, cattle ranching serves as a territorial strategy. There are 90 clandestine airstrips along the Mexican-Guatemalan border. These ranches are being built, cattle ranches, look like cattle ranches. Sometimes there's not even cattle on them. But the pasture is built to hide an airstrip right along the border. And that image you see perfectly encapsulated here. There are about 90 of those airstrips. Reporters and stakeholders of the Maya Biosphere Reserve call it the cemetery of planes. They just leave those little planes that they brought cocaine from the Andes, and then the drugs get smuggled to Mexico and then onto the frat houses and boardrooms of the United States. The third way that cattle ranching works for these criminal organizations is that they're actually using heifers to transport drugs across state lines, international lines. Seems incredulous, but remind yourself, this practice is already being done with people. So it seems that in the Maya Biosphere Reserve, cattle have become mules. Now, this complex combination of landless, indigenous, poor settlers illegally squatting in those national parks and farming because they can't do it anywhere else, and drug trafficking organizations coming in and ranching in the Maya Biosphere Reserve, this dynamic by Maya Biosphere stakeholders, politicians, conservation organizations, they call it ingobernabilidad. La ingobernabilidad de la Reserva de Biosfera Maya, the ingovernability of the Maya Biosphere Reserve. And in these policies, it kind of looks like this when I go to these meetings. And there'll be the Minister of the Environment, you have the leaders of the organizations, the community forestry organizations, you've got Wildlife Conservation Society, the Nature Conservancy. Everybody's around the table, round table. In these settings, indigenous people, the poor farmers, get blamed for all of the deforestation. And the narco ranchers aren't even mentioned. There are three reasons why that happens. In this setting, there'll be a couple of people who are directly in the pockets of the narco ranchers, right? So those individuals within the government who have links to drug trafficking organizations are very happy for the poor Quechi Maya to be the face of deforestation, scapegoated for deforestation. Two, everybody else who's in the room knows that they would be risking their lives to denounce those activities in these types of activities, in these types of circles, right? To denounce a narco rancher, if you're living and working in Guatemala, is to risk your life. And three, the labor dynamics of narco ranching in the western part of the reserve are quite complex and enable indigenous people to be scapegoated. And I want to walk you through the labor process of converting a forest to a narco ranch, a narco finca, in the Maya Biosphere Reserve. So here's the narco rancher, and actually we should have, you know, a representative from a cartel sort of higher up that provides the capital to the rancher, okay? So the ranchers are getting money from drug trafficking organizations to launder. They buy supplies, chainsaws, seed, they pay for the labor, the transport, and you know what? Sometimes these narco ranchers go into small villages south of the Maya Biosphere, and they might come with a local diputado. And they say, hey, we've got work for you. We're going to provide you a bus. You can have land. And there's a possibility that that land title might become yours one day. So there's an interesting labor recruitment process that happens here, too. The workers are taken out to Laguna del Tigre or Sierra de la Candón, where they're paid $5 a day to cut down trees, to burn them. And we're talking about large tracts of land. And maybe on one or two manzanas, sort of a hectare or two, which be the traditional size of a Sweden agriculture plot, the narco rancher will let the peasant farmers or the peasant employees do one or two crop cycles, mostly corn and beans. But after just one season of cultivation, in comes the seed for grass and the cattle. And we see a conversion from a large tract of land deforested, small plot being cultivated, to the entire thing being made into a cattle ranch. And then the money goes back to the narco rancher, and we would need to have our cartel member in this loop as well. Now, as I've mentioned before, the discourse of ingovernability only focuses on these components because it looks quite similar to Swinan agricultural practices of the indigenous farmers who are not being employed by narco ranchers. And this discourse of ingovernability translates into military action. Indigenous villages in the Western parks have been evicted violently by the army, often using tactics that resemble the Scorched Earth campaign in Guatemala's Civil War. And the fact that indigenous people are scapegoated for deforestation while the narcos are being let off the hook really makes me mad. I came to this project and to Texas State wanting to sort of tease out what percentage of deforestation is attributed to cattle ranching versus what percentage of deforestation is attributed to Sweden agricultural practices. And as I mentioned before, you know, the injustice comes from the idea here is that just focusing on this component of the cycle of deforestation is just looking at the tip of the iceberg. And I like to use this slide because this is how it's explained to me by my colleagues working in Guatemala. So this is not just my take, but the take of people that I'm working with there. And the indigenous people know what's going on. They know they're being scapegoated. And one evictee that I talked to powerfully told me, they burned down our houses and the sacks of corn we had without explanation. We are not cattle ranchers. We are agriculturalists, right? So even the peasants who are being evicted know that they're being scapegoated for deforestation and see the injustice as well as the legacies of civil war violence, right? Burning down the entire village, destroying all crops, etc. So I came to Texas State, and Texas State geography has a specialization in remote sensing and GIS, and I went to my colleague, Dr. Nate Kurt, who has worked in this area before, and I said, Nate, we have got to get a handle and quantify these different drivers of deforestation. And he said, let's try. So what we've done is we've gotten two sets of data from our colleagues in Guatemala. I've been working in Guatemala since 2005, but 2009 in the Maya Biosphere Reserve. And now, you know, 3 or 4 years after going back and forth, I've finally gained the trust of these organizations and the people that are really fighting for the environment and poor people in the reserve. And they gave us two data sets. One data set is land cover and land use. All right, so this is remote sensing. Supervised classification is the term to determine what the land use and land cover is and track changes over time. Okay, so we have here land cover and land use in the year 2000, and we really wanted to focus on three areas of the reserve that have been hit hardest by narco ranching. Okay, Laguna del Tigre, Sierra de Lacandon. We're going to be talking a lot about Laguna del Tigre, so I want you to remember that one in particular, but Sierra de Lacandon. And this is the route to Carmelita. Carmelita, I told you, is where I did my ethnography. But unfortunately, narco ranchers have been infiltrating that route as well. So we see narco ranching as a phenomenon there. And what we saw between 2000 and 2015 was a fantastic amount of forest loss. Okay? So what you see here in red is areas that have transitioned from forest to agriculture. This is the highest deforestation rates in the world during the 2000s. And when you look at Laguna del Tigre National Park, we see 30% forest loss in 15 years. You know, just phenomenal. 15% in Sierra de Lacandon. And 23% forest loss in that middle area, which we call the route to Carmelita. So here, looking side by side, you sort of get a sense of what land use cover looked like in 2000, 2015. But the limitations of remote sensing are this. The classification of agropecuario, agriculture, combines the two land uses that we precisely want to disentangle. Agriculture as a land cover could either be a ranch or it could be a Sweden farm. The satellite images and the spectral signatures that we get back don't allow for us to distinguish what's ranching versus what's farming. So to get at that, we had to turn to a second data set that our friends at I think they're happy to. Wildlife Conservation Society and the Council for National Protected Areas in Guatemala provided us. And you know, those lovely people, they're happy to talk about cattle, but they are not able to make the links to drug trafficking organizations. So I really see that as sort of being where I can come in and share the message about what's happening. So they have this data set of cattle presence. And they have looked at those three troubled areas and over 4 years have driven have flown a similar flight line that you see outlined here to sort of get a sense for the presence and change in cattle in the Maya Biosphere Reserve. And remember, there's supposed to be no cattle whatsoever. Narrowing in on Laguna de Tigre, you can see here the different flight lines and the ways in which they do or they do not overlap. And we're talking about over 12,000 photographs for the three areas for the 4 years. So as an ethnographer a year and a half ago, I went to Nate and I said, can't we combine the land use cover classification data with the presence of cattle? And where we have agricultural land use classification with cattle, we can say that's cattle ranching. When there's no cattle, we can say that's farming. He said, let's try. So that's what we're trying to do. Take these two data sets produced by our Guatemalan colleagues and combine them to disentangle what percentage of cattle ranching what percentage of deforestation is driven by cattle ranching. And this is what we got. Okay, this is how they do it. They've got all these images. And if any of these markers of cattle ranching or cattle presence is there, well, then yes, there was cattle ranching in that picture. So this is what it looks like when you combine those two data sets in GIS. You can see our land use classification with the overlay of cattle ranching presence. So our question is, what percentage of all aerial photographs are classified as agropecuario, agriculture, also display evidence of cattle ranching? And sort of qualitatively, people have been telling me between 60 and 80% of deforestation they thought was driven by narco ranching. And what we got from our analysis was quite similar. The route to Carmelita, 62% of deforested lands had cattle on them, 76% in Sierra de la Candón, and 68% in Laguna de Tigre. 70%, I mean, it blows my mind, right? So the idea is that we can take this data then to policymakers and provide them this information to understand what the drivers of deforestation are. And we're getting into some more complex stuff that we could talk about in a Q&A in terms of measuring area and adjusting our methods for some of the ways in which the previous methodology overestimated and underestimated cattle ranching. But I'll save that for those of you who are interested. Now, with the few remaining minutes that I have for the next 6 or 7 minutes or so, I want to tell you about the good news. What's working in the East? What's responsible for that beautiful forest cover and the remainder of the Maya biosphere, where the community forest concessions are located? When the Maya biosphere was created in 1990, people living in Carmelita and Washaktun and a dozen other villages in the Maya biosphere experienced park creation as land dispossession. All of a sudden, they have the state coming in, telling them how many animals they can or cannot kill, which is their food, their subsistence, how much wood they can use for their homes, for their fuel, where they can plant milpa, where they can't do it, despite the fact that they've been living there for over 100 years. And when they got wind of the plan of the government to create industrial forest concessions, they organized in resistance and said, we don't want industrial forest concessions in our territorial lands. If you're going to do concessions, they need to be community forest concessions. And in 1995, reserve residents created the Association of Petén's Forest Communities that coordinates and legally represents all of the 12 concessions. The creation of 12 concessions between 1994 and 2000 involved years of work and cost the lives of several people to make this system come to fruition. Countless meetings and communities, the creation of cooperatives for each of the concessions, and these concessions are 25-year contracts that the government gives communities that legally give them the right to sustainably harvest timber and non-timber forest products. They had to meet with the World Bank, the Nature Conservancy, CI, USAID. And when those diplomatic measures didn't produce the results they wanted, they took to the streets and protested and organized in defense of their land rights. And now, after I said, you know, from 94 to 2000, the creation of 12 community concessions. You can see them here in the dark gray. The white are the national parks, and then the striped ones are the two industrial concessions. This is a tough business for these communities. They've got to create cooperatives. They sign 25-year contracts with the Council of National Protected Areas. Every year they have to have an annual plan of operation that details which tree they're going to cut, how much reforestation is taking place. The wood has to be certified by the Forest Stewardship Council. They have to comply with conservation law, meaning that they don't sell land, they don't have cattle, and they have to denounce illegal activities taking place within their territory. And if they don't do all of those things, they're subject to cancellation and eviction. Now, after 20 years, that forest cover attests to the diversity of practices that entails community forestry. These are the firefighters, not only fighting forest fires, but doing fire lines and information systems for farmers in the reserve. They monitor biodiversity and wildlife. That curious-looking thing is a tapir. They participate in reforestation, and they patrol their concession areas. Now, community forestry economically has many benefits. This is the social justice part, not just the environmental justice part. 3,000 jobs a year, paying three times the minimum wage. We have now, 20 years later, forest technicians, carpentry shops. $14 million a year is produced through timber, and that's distributed among the 30,000 people who benefit from this process. There's also the production of a leafy palm called shate that goes into flower bouquets, makes $8 million a year. And despite what this photo indicates, women are actually the ones who are running the shate business. And of course, we have the traditional chicle, but that's more of sort of a historical practice. Okay. So I mentioned to you that while most people agree that community forestry has worked better than putting land into national park, it's a highly uneven process. Two concessions have been canceled and villagers evicted by the army. And another one is under suspension. Now, when people talk about success and failure of community forestry, I also get really irritated. And the reason being is they say, oh, Carmelita and Washaktun are successful because they're chicle villages. They have a culture of care for the forest. That's ridiculous. Because it leads them to say, oh, where Cruz de la Colorada and La Colorada are, those are recent migrants to the Maya Biosphere Reserve. They don't have that culture of care for the forest. That's why they've deforested. That's why they've sold their lands. That's why the concessions failed. But that simplistic, almost culturally determinist argument misses the fact that the people here in that route to Carmelita have been threatened with their lives almost daily by narco traffickers. And the leader of the Control and Vigilance Committee for one of those concessions, David Salguero, 31 years old, was murdered in the community concessions offices. You know, the narco shows up and he says, sell me your land. And Don Paco says, I can't sell you my land, it's illegal, we'll lose it. He says, well, I'll come back in 2 months and offer your widow half the amount I'm offering you today. This is not a story of migrants selling their land because they're not good forest stewards. This is, again, the way in which narco-trafficking is impacting the concession process and being invisibilized by the way that people talk about it in public policy circles. Now, Carmelita and Washaktun, yes, emblematic success stories. Very different paths to success. They have fought tooth and nail, and constantly have to work to make this process sustainable. To say that they are successful because of their roots is to ignore the technical, administrative, social dynamics and challenges that have defined their processes. And then I'm also looking in my book project at another case study, the Rio Chanchich, which is interesting. Maybe you know this story. This was a group of contraband timber extractors who formalized and legalized their extraction, their timber extraction through the community forestry business, and are now like environmental stewards and flown all over the world to talk about their process. So we're not looking at one model or one proceso like many people talk about. We're actually talking about many models and many processes that define community forestry. And if we want to argue that community forestry is viable, then we need to get away from these simplistic narratives of cultural determinism, that you have to be a 100-year village in the Maya Biosphere Reserve to be successful. The evidence doesn't bear it out, and it limits the possibilities for community-led resource management elsewhere. So to conclude, I want to say a couple of things about where I think this story might fit into some broader policy and theoretical analysis. So despite the limitations of community forestry elsewhere throughout the world, I'm arguing that the case of community forestry in the Maya Biosphere shows that community-led resource management can be an environmentally and socially just strategy. What's fascinating about this story, this is a multi-ethnic movement. Most successful community-based resource management programs in Latin America especially are indigenous-based. But here we have a story in which not only are multiple ethnicities working together, we actually have former guerrillas working alongside former members of the army in leadership positions. And it's fascinating, and I'll get into it in the book, and we could talk about the Q&A, how they were able to forge an identity, the forest concessionaire, that provided the glue that has enabled this community resource management program to work. And really, you know, I'm arguing this is a site of transformative politics. I get really irritated as well with the whole green governmentality stuff and that community-led resource management is just making good neoliberal green subjects. That ain't the community foresters. They are using community forestry as a political platform to claim land rights and have transformed themselves into powerful political players, not only in Bataan, not only in the nation, but in the global conservation community. So these are some really important political opportunities and implications. Second, narco-ecologies. We don't even have a handle on the ways in which drug trafficking and drug production are impacting the environment. It's different in the Andes. Glyphosate, right? Different sort of environmental impact than laundering money and trafficking through creating clandestine airstrips and laundering through cattle ranching. And I just became part of a large international team that's looking at illicit drivers of land use change throughout Central America. So I'm very excited to be able to be in a position in the near future to really be able to share the message I'm sharing with you today with people in U.S. Congress as well as the United Nations. And then lastly, environmental policy is drug policy in the Americas. Right? Usually these policy realms remain separate, but we need to think about the ways in which they influence one another. The US Congress approved $1 billion in the Plan for Prosperity to go to the Northern Triangle, the three countries of Honduras, El Salvador, and Guatemala to fight drug trafficking, to improve democracy and economic development. That money should not go to the Guatemalan government. It should go to organizations like ACOFOP, the Association of Bataan's Forest Community, that are actually the front line in stopping drug traffickers from taking over the entirety of the reserve. So there are really important policy implications. And I think I'll stop there and open it up for questions. I provided you a big overview. Thanks for your patience, and I'm interested to hear what you have to say. Thank you.